May regular May meeting to be held by the committee of high school district 100 North of Order. May I have a roll call?
Yes. Figueroa?
Yes.
Kate?
Here.
Dowd?
Here.
Lewis? Riddzinski? Rego?
Here.
King Paul Tom?
We have a call. President King Paul Tom is absent this evening. Can I have a motion and a second to move the vice president as a president pro temp?
So moved.
Second.
Roll call?
Rego?
Yes.
Figueroa?
Yes.
Kate?
Yes.
Dowd?
Yes.
Would I take a moment of silence today for the victims of the senseless violence that occurred in Buffalo and Bob Elementary School? Please join me in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
James, could you please read our definition of police and white police statements?
Yes, Kate. Our definition statement: cultivate successful, passionate, empowered learners through rigor, relevance, and relationships. Our Fenton belief statements: successful, passionate, empowered learners thrive when we provide a safe, caring, welcoming environment, diversity, equity, and inclusion, unify our community, school, home, collaborate as one. We champion innovative teaching and engaged learning with state-of-the-art facilities. We infuse social-emotional learning into academics and culture. We prepare students to fulfill their civic responsibility. We immerse students in authentic life experiences. Device and way. Students and adults at Fenton High School create a safe and empathetic environment where we believe in each other, respect diversity, communicate openly, grow together, and hold each other to high expectations to become the leaders and innovators of the future.
Recently, one of our board members exercised their First Amendment right to first speech and shared a social media post. Individual board members acting outside of their role as a school board member do not necessarily represent the views and values of the district and are not intended to be a reflection of Fenton School and the Bison Way. We want to remind everyone that the Bison Way reflects our district's standing police system, which is why we need it before all of our meetings. According to the Bison Way, students and adults at Fenton High School create a safe, caring, empathetic environment where we believe in each other, respect diversity, communicate openly, grow together, and hold each other to high expectations, become the leaders and innovators of the future. Mary, do you have any requests for public comment?
Yes, we have one. David Shimon.
Mary, you are going?
Yes.
Perfect.
You're welcome.
Hello, everyone. First of all, I'd like to say thank you to the board for your service. My name is Dave Shimon. I've been a resident of Woodale, where my wife and I have had three children that have attended Fenton High School. As Woodale shrinks in population, by the industrial buildings moving into neighborhoods north of Foster and 83, the population of the school will not be growing. I would like to provide the following information regarding the request of voters for the $129.7 million for Fenton remodel. Just as a reminder, in 2012, the FHS Board of Education spent $50,000 for a comprehensive facility. In 2013, a six-phase plan was accepted in phases one and three to begin immediately. Phase one and three were completed in 2015, at a cost of $16 million, $15 million in reserve, and another $1 million in regular bonds, more or less. Phase 4 through 6 were not continued by the Fenton Board. I have no idea why. One concern is that the value of a home of $229,000, the additional tax burden would be $395, as stated on the website. In percentage terms, that could mean an increase of over 25% of the current tax burden denoted under High School District 100 in our tax bill, not included any amounts that are paid to the pension fund. In addition to the above, I would ask the FHS board to consider having a referendum next year to ask the community if they would support the consolidation of District 100, District 7, and District 2 into one school district. The goal would be to reduce redundancies and gain efficiencies, especially at the administrative level. You know, I sat in the same chairs that you guys did a number of years ago when a new superintendent was being voted on. There was a lot of discourse at that time regarding the new superintendent. At that time, as a board member, I voted against the contract for the new superintendent, stating, I believe it is the correct person for the job, yet the contract I cannot support. I would say something similar here, as I believe it can be the correct idea to do what you're doing with the funds of looking at $129 million. Just not at this time and for what you're looking to do. The student population will decrease in Wooddale as industrial buildings replace neighborhoods. It may be best to just build a new right-sized school, maybe in the FHS parking lots, while the old school is being used. I don't know if $129 million will get you there, but there you go. Thank you very much.
Good evening. Even though the school year is over, we still are honoring these tremendous accomplishments throughout this school year. I'm going to start with the chess team. Tonight we recognize them for qualifying for the IHSA state finals. One fascinating side note is, obviously they qualified last year in sort of a remote setting where they weren't really together very much, but obviously they gelled very nicely and went to state again this year. In fact, it's the 15th consecutive year the chess team has qualified for the IHSA state finals. Streak intact, we're going to announce this year's team: Alejandro Aguilar Carrera, Maximiliano Diaz. Yeah, come on, you come up a little closer. Yeah, come on up. Thank you. Victor, Adamari Gomez, Victor Bruska, Drew Salski, David Severiano, Eric Zine, Brenna Ralston, Emilio Sanchez, Sarah Schaefer, and Naomi Zine. And last but not least, our leader of this highly successful program is going to step down.
We'd like to thank the board for recognizing us here tonight. This is the first time we've been at a board meeting in 2 years, I think. Last year, we rebuilt our chess team after graduating our top 8 players to play an entirely online chess season. This year, most of our team had to learn how to compete in over-the-board chess, that's what we call it, play over-the-board instead of online, for the first time. Coach Bible couldn't be here tonight, but we both like to thank our administration for the support we had as we navigated an in-person chess season through COVID. I'm so proud of this team for the progress they made and their success in this extra challenging year. competed in crowded rooms wearing masks for 10 hours a day, and they always represented Fenton well. We qualified for state in a very tough sectional and finished 13th overall in Division 3A at state. We had a few standout performances with Adamari Gomez earning 5 points at board 7 and 8, and Drew Salsky, a sophomore, earning 4.5 points at board 1. Coach Babb and I are very proud of them, and we can't wait for another season.
And if we could all come forward to take a picture with the team, that'd be great. Probably right in this area.
Developing a lesson plan, creating beautiful props. She spent a lot of time on them.
and memorizing a children's story, and she actually kind of wrote her own story. She developed her own twist on the classic story of the Three Little Pigs. Esther gracefully took feedback from judges at the regional competition and made improvements for the state competition, which she did successfully. I remember some feedback she got. Some of the judges from the regional competition were also at state, and they just, like, were raving about how much she, like, improved and listened and did such a great job. Esther has expressed to me that she is interested in pursuing a career in education, and I know, Esther, you've been talking about elementary or high school or even teaching family consumer sciences. And I think that is an excellent choice. I truly believe that Esther is a great leader who will have a great impact on children's lives no matter what age group she decides to work with. I want to thank administrators at Fenton who not only support and see the importance of FCCLA, but also the Family and Consumer Sciences Department as a whole. I can't wait to see the years to come how FCCLA and our Family Consumer Science classes will continue to impact students and inspire them to chase their career goals and to make a difference in this world. Thank you again, Esther, for all of your hard work this year, and I'm excited to work with you next year, too, and thank you for everyone for being here.
Our state qualifiers here tonight are Noelia Vasquez, who compiled a 22-1 record this season and later earned third place at state this year. Yameli Petaloza, who finished 13-3 in the regular season, and Yanel Perez with a 12-6 record in the regular season. Sophia Sosa was an honorable mention, wasn't able to make it tonight, but we wanted to also say that she was an alternate and did travel with the team this year. So we're going to turn it over to Coach Hasty.
Well, thank you again for recognizing us and your support. We very much appreciate it. And I'm super proud of the ladies. So 3 years ago, a group of young, courageous ladies inquired about joining our program. And I think anyone around the program, around wrestling, knows that it's a super competitive, super physically and mentally challenging, you know, thing to do, activity to partake in. So Noelia was one of those young ladies 3 years ago. And right away, I think the girls in our program really worked hard and had a lot of immediate success. And Noelia was kind of the ringleader of them. So her first year, she was a state qualifier. It was canceled because of COVID. So she was not able to compete in the state tournament. Last year in the IWCOA state tournament, the IHSA didn't officially recognize women's wrestling last year because she was a state champion with a 13-0 record. And then this year, she ended up having a 27-2 record and taking third in the state. So an exceptional career, 40-2 the last 2 years, taking first and third in the state. Incredible. She just got back from PT training, serving with the Marines. So she's been looking forward to serving our country for years. So she's been a great leader, and then we had two new young ladies join us this year, Gabby Penalazzo and Penalosa, 14-5, so a sophomore, and she just really kind of got better as the year went on. As sectional, she actually beat the girl to fifth in the state, so her potential is pretty great. And then, you know, Perez, who likes this move called a headlock, 12-8, maybe 12 of her victories might be via headlock. Maybe, you know,
we're guessing. Is that legal?
No, it's promoted.
Okay, all right, okay.
Do you want to demonstrate?
What? Ready? I got four of something, you know?
What a sportsman. Nice. Yeah, I'm very proud of their accomplishments, and we have a great group of girls, and we are, you know, hopefully continuing to grow and get other great young ladies out with us, and it's been fun, and we will definitely miss Noelia. It's easy to kind of have a team with a leader like that. I think the most impressive thing about Noelia is she's the first woman in Fenton's wrestling history to be a captain of our team, and that just says everything. And Fenton's, you know, the wrestling history here, going back to 1972, just being state champs in 73 is, you know, outstanding. And, you know, she's going to be part of history forever, and these young ladies will work to kind of get to her level. So thank you.
Can you see that?
thing. All right, so the next item is our website. Dr. Jim Madison, our director of technology, and myself, we are exploring the possibility of changing our website to Travelers. The current website has become a bit stale, and we are just curious, and we've experienced some cause for concern regarding providing. Our site has gone offline several times over the few months because of issues out of control.
Can you speak up a little bit?
Sure. The current website has become stale in regards to its appearance, and we've had some cause for concern as far as reliability. Our site has gone offline several times in the last 2 months, and for reasons that are outside of our control. So for that reason, we've been looking. Aside from the look and feel, which we do want to be upgraded, the current website has some bugs in the tools, and some of the more desirable features require a bit more technological experience. The average staff member isn't knowledgeable enough to navigate either one of those complexities, which means the website kind of falls on a select few people. We're exploring other options, and we hope to have a proposal at one of the next board meetings. The goal is to make the website more modern, so that we showcase our many successes, communicate to our community more effectively, and minimize the number of unplanned outages. We have a lot of really incredible success stories and a lot of important information that we want to be seen, and that we want to be seen when they need to be seen. So we're going to stay on the road. And as I touched on before, we also want to expand the accessibility to other members of our team, minimize the outages, and some of the sites that we're looking at are a lot more user-friendly, so we have more people using them, and they will stay accessible. Dr. Batson and I are in the early stages of this exploration, but we're very optimistic. We'll have more information to come.
Next up is an interview report by Dr. Orlando.
Hello everyone, my name is Mike Bragel, and this is your Equity Report. Here are our commemorative observances and holidays for the month of March, April, and May. In March, we celebrated Women's History Month in many ways. Throughout the entire month, we recognized women leaders of the past and today through school announcements and window decorations. On March 16th, students and staff wrote thank you notes to women within our building, which were then posted on our wall at the front entrance of the school. On the 24th, we hosted a successful women's empowerment panel that consisted of staff and students. The panel focused on our panelists' lived experiences and overcoming challenges that educated students and provided awareness to those who were in attendance. We capped off our celebration with a video of inspiring women in our building talking about other women within our building and outside who have influenced them throughout their lives. This month, we focused on mental health awareness. The main goals were to break down the stigma that often comes with mental health and provide students with resources so they know where to go or who to reach out to for help. On May 3rd, students decorated windows in our lunch commons with information about the most common mental health challenges that people face. With it, we added pictures of famous people who are thriving with mental health challenges. On May 11th, Ms. Bray and Student Council placed positive quotes on student lockers. Ms. Rajendran and her AP Psychology students created a video on breaking the stigma about mental health, which we aired on May 17th during Bison Time. That same day, we distributed crisis hotline cards to all of our students. Big shout out to Ms. Rajendran and Ms. McDougall for helping out with the planning and to all of the students who made it all happen. We have scheduled our DEI training for staff members who have not gone through our required baseline training. On June 22nd, we have 13 participants and 7 during the July 5th training. For those who are unable to attend the daytime training, we're offering Thursday evening training during the school year. We currently have 12 participants sign up. For any new teacher and admins, they will get together as a cohort and do their training throughout the school year on a monthly basis. Dr. Yvette Dubio will be leading the charge in all of the training. On June 20th and 21st, our District Equity Leadership Team, also known as DELT, will gather to reflect on the progress that we have made this year and to plan for our Equity Action Plan 2.0, EAP. Our goal by the end of our retreat is to have a 3-year Equity Action Plan that coincides with our 3-year strategic plan. The plan will ensure that our district continues to move the equity needle in the right direction. Our Equity Action Plan website dashboard will also be updated with new goals and continue to demonstrate our progress. Lastly, I'd like to give a big shout out to our strand leaders, Ms. Ranjana Rajendran, Ms. Michelle Rodriguez, Mr. Jason Madel, Mr. Josh Payton, Mr. Jim Batson, Mr. James Ontango, and the rest of our DELT team for dedicating their time and effort to this important work. None of our progress would have been possible without this team. That concludes our equity report. Until next time, thank you and have a great day.
Lighting, traffic, and these common areas, to improve and save facilities. Our students will perform better. We are definitely convinced of that. They will have a new concept, sense of pride, which is an end quote. Our students visit other high schools. They really do. They know what's there. They know what's just like other students. So we serve their potential and have their expectations for curriculars. We'll have an opportunity to follow their passion for actually helping basically prepare for the next step for careers and careers. But these are the futures we want for our children. Just the fiscal aspect here, we must act on. Each year, the improvement needed by our school becomes more expensive. That's how it is. And runs contrary to the efforts to make our district more fiscally responsible. As Bruce and I always want to say, we need to be fiscally responsible for at least 5 years. We've taken important steps to control spending and ensure as much money as possible goes into the classroom and schools. Here I stress out this is a building referendum. It's not an operation, it's not a salary, it's for building facilities. Fenton has the lowest bond and interest unemployment tax rate among high school districts in DuPage County. Overall tax rate debt is significantly lower than the state average. That's on our flyer. What does that really mean for our board here? It means you guys have been fiscally responsible tax dollars the last year. Our kids discern the same opportunities provided by other districts and communities. This plan will develop very for our kids, it's safer and for essential learning for all of our students. And I'll talk about more. Basically say hope for coaching.
Staff member that is typically not eligible for insurance benefits due to
year, there's a history. Traditionally, it's been the fourth Wednesday of the month. This year, we tried something a little different. We did the third. And just feedback from the administrators, specifically our business side, who pays the bills, okay, and invoices, we are requesting, again, to go back to our old schedule. The fourth, it's just easier for us to transition and pay for our bills, complete our invoices, send out our invoices, and so forth. That's the This is absolutely Bruce's fault. And I wanted to put his picture there. So we're gonna make a motion for this like action items. But here it is. I just quickly review. So it will be our July meeting. When this kicks off on July 27th. It's always the fourth Wednesday. Mary, is there anything different? Look, there's two that I've
There's two that I've three. It's the third Wednesday of the month only because of the holidays. So November and December.
November and December.
One aspect is policy committee, two aspects finance and facilities committee, and three aspects is DEI committee.
What happens if the platform passes out of the facilities? So this will come up at the action item where you are. Next up is our date in the government. According to the board, there's an IGA for the Fulton School District that sends their students to TCE, a vocational CTE extension program. There's a great paper that the community for enrollment has gone up and we're continuing to grow these programs. Okay, I just want to get through the final. There's two things that needs to happen for the IGA. Take place. Number one, the Dais Board, which I am a member of, and actually the president, okay, needs to approve it. It was approved last week. Then we take it to you guys, right? And you guys have all 14 listed. Okay? And here are the sticking points. There's two parts. The first one is really just changing the name. For example, Dais used to be called Dais. So they crossed that out. Then, for clarity, what happens if TCE fails and equal terminology dissolves or goes away or district says no? This is what happens. Next slide, please. Number one, there is no talk about TCE failing. Okay, just want to get to that. But this is just an IGA. Put it on the contract, I love that agreement, just in case something happens. In the case that it does happen where we decide to dissolve it, we need the language in the IGA agreement to be clear. Here's what we agreed on last week. There were two appraisals. So there were two appraisals that took place in 1987. How much does TCE cost? $19 million. We did another appraisal last year. It jumped up to $31 million. The difference between 8721 is this number. The reason why I'm saying it is at the next slide. $11 million and so forth. So, we Fenton was a founding district for 8. Our seed money we contributed was $300,000. And with that first appraisal, we can go back. we thought that the fairest way is to do it by the 10-year average percentage of openness. Currently, we chose a great date on 2030, right? Last 10 years, our average percentage is 4%. If it is that number, we would get half a million dollars. Just to solve, we take that 1.6 plus half a million. Thank you.
Grego?
Yes.
Figueroa?
Yes.
Lee?
Yes.
Delwood?
Yes.
Motion carries. Now we'll move on to the 2022-23 Board of Education meeting date.
So a little board is it's that time of year where we choose when you guys meet. We would like to go back to the fourth Wednesday of the month to make Bruce's travel a little easier. So we have to adjust the schedule to meet his needs next year.
We had to relive that second time.
in all reality, it makes sense.
May I have a motion that the Board of Education approve the 2022-23 Board of Education meeting date schedule as presented?
So
moved.
Kennedy?
Yes.
Rojas?
Grego?
Yes.
Figueroa?
Yes.
Lee?
Yes.
Delwood?
Yes.
Motion carries. Move on to Bruce, the school bus purchases. I know you're mistaken here.
So we have a bus purchase recommendation for you this evening. And some of you may recall we brought a recommendation to you last June for a very similar questions. Their buses that are coming up from a 5-year lease. We entered into this lease in 2017 with Midwest Transit, which is our leasing partner, along with St. Andrew Bank, they usually have for this. And that lease will end in next month or in July, I should say. We did evaluate the various options, but instead of one more year, entering into a new lease, purchasing the buses, and in the end, after we looked at the purchase price of a brand new bus with similar features, which is about $105,000, so that's up quite a bit from the last time I checked on that. About a year ago or so, the purchase price of a similarly equipped bus was $15,000. So it's just up quite a bit from this $105,000 number. So to buy a new bus is significantly more than what we're recommending here. But after reviewing the options to enter into a new lease or extended, we feel the best option, most prudent option now is to buy these two buses. We do evaluate the condition of the buses. We have a full-time mechanic in control of that. He's does an excellent job, a lot of experience. He has done a thorough review of the condition of the buses. The bodies are in excellent shape. Oftentimes you'll see that that includes first with the buses, they may look horrible on the outside, but underneath they're running fine from the engine standpoint. In our case, the whole things are good inside and out, so we're fortunate there. But the buses are 2016 models, they're 71 passenger buses, which is consistent with our fleet. We have relatively low miles. We don't put a lot of miles in, we have a relatively small square mile in the district, so our routes are shorter. So the purchase price is $39,904 for each bus. That's up about 32% from last year, so I'll just share that with you. Last year at this time, we paid a little bit over $30,000, $30,194. That is a pretty good jump, but we still think the value is there as opposed to leasing and entering into a lease or purchasing brand new. So we are recommending to purchase these two buses with a total purchase price of that $79,817. We do have funds for it. We would pay for it out of this year's budget, so the 2020 for that. But that's where our recommendation is for these two buses. The lease price was about $11,000, roughly. Coming off of
cost of housing, they're less than probably 30, 40,000 miles. They're not a lot of miles. Diesel's gone, run, they're all about diesel vehicles. Yeah, so they last a long time. We expect these buses to last another at least 5, 6, 7 years. So they're going to be around for per bus for 1 year, so we would have paid about $26,000-$27,000 for 1 year extension.
May I have a motion that the Board of Education approve the financial advisory agreement? May I have a motion that the Board of Education approve the purchase of 2016 school buses for a price of $39,904 per bus for the U.S. Transit Department. The total purchase price is $79,880. To be paid from the 2021-22 budget year. Yo, and a roll call?
Yes. Rita?
Yes.
Figueroa?
Yes.
Kate?
Yes.
Joey?
Yes.
Well, we have some of our kids there that are well over 10, 12 years. They went to trial. There's no legal termination fee or the new type of bus. But obviously, when you get into that 15-year range, you kind of want to look at the debt at that point.
Yes, you're up against financial advisory.
Okay, thank you very much. So as you all know, we're kind of exploring this referendum opportunity, and that thing was kind of like we had this evening. This advisor agreement is a legal document that will be used for the district and its financial advisor. And in fact, this case will be with Todd Percy, who is now affiliated with PMA Financial Advisors. And we've already been using PMA for our investments, but they also provide the bond services as well. So he's with a much larger organization, a lot of expertise. He thinks it's a great fit. The agreement that you have there outlines expectations and obligations between the parties, including the role and responsibilities of the advisor, their compensation, confidentiality, and assignment support. It is necessary to the point of financial referendum. PMA will provide financial services as a financial advisor and is registered as a municipal advisor with the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission, the SEC, and the MSRB. I kind of highlight some sections there of the scope of services that would be provided. Section 1 talks about specifically about the financial planning analysis, financial financing, regulations for securities, market information, and collections. Section 2 that management financial information and companies. Section 4 talks about the terms of the agreement, how long the debt will be in effect. Chose to terminate the agreement as in Section 5, where the agreement goes to either party. And I think Section 6 is really important, private compensation, expense reimbursement, of course, is critical. Fees to the PMA are outlined in page 8, so there's a fee schedule there. It is important to note that no fee shall be due to the district to PMA unless the referendum passes and the securities close. And we have done a comparison of proposed fee schedules of similar projects. This is in line or not in line. It's been a little bit less in certain cases of other bond projects that are better compared with our proposed one. So we feel the pricing that they're proposing is reasonable. And then does require a weapon of aggression, and that Treasurer shall be either a member of the board who serves a 1-year term, or a non-member who serves as the board and the board's pleasure. And if that affects the board, the joint chief financial officer, as the treasurer, should the board appoint the chief financial officer as treasurer, the attachment of the resolution will be the action. So we included that resolution. This is having the board take this to the board to act on the treasurer, and the resolution and certification. His name was in the resolution, Bruce Martin.
Thank you.
just an informational item. We kind of briefed you a little bit last month. We do have an annual renewal every year. We want to be insurance cooperative, educational benefit cooperative. We have 123 schools that are part of this. Medical plans, or the PPO plan, we offer three different plans. We offer a PPO plan, we offer a traditional plan. The medical plan for the PPO will increase by 6.5%, and the HMO plan will increase by 9.7%. And the dental plan, we also have under this program, a nice 3.7%. We're coming off of a decrease of deaths we're in now. A lot of elective surgeries and things like that were delayed that are now kind of, medical services are kind of ramping up now and kind of driving across the community. It's been in effect with DVC, Educational Benefit Cooperative, since 1984. We've been a member for about 13 years, so in 2009 we joined Fenton. So I think it's worked out well. But the purpose really is to provide economies of scale and risk pools that will allow members to reap a lot of the financial stability of their insurance products. The other thing I think that is critical, crucial, is we remember we do retain the right to and ability to re-change our plans as we so fit, see fit. And of course, that's often required by the insurance collective bargaining. So our plan will be different than we do have that autonomy to develop the plan that you see work best for your district. I'm not going to go through all this, but I can explain a little bit about the demanding formula and how they arrive at the increase in various bands and quality levels that you fall into that based on your experience and where your rates would fall. But if you look at a separately from the handout, the demanding formula, the three adjustments. We actually our loss claim ratio of paid claims were under the pool average, so we fell under the average increase for the PPO of 7.5. We came in at 6.5%, so we did well there. The HMO claims we were right in the middle, so we were at the average. The average increase for the HMO was 9.7%. And then dental claims we were at the average as well. So the majority of districts fell in the middle as we did at 3.7%. There are some outliers that are lower than that, and then some that are experiencing greater things that are higher than that. And then we also have life and AD&D coverage through them, and then those rates are firm through 2023. So this information is all shared during open enrollment, which just ended last week, so our staff during the basically the first 3 or 4 weeks of May for our staff to participate in. This year it was an all online. Well, actually we did an in-person informational sessions, but there's no more paperwork to enroll or changes to make through a paper process. It's all done through a self-serve electronic system. So we launched that this year. I think it's done pretty well this year. I think my fellow administrators have all done well with it, so they're all, they've all updated their information, and so we're very happy with how that's going. Our staff is doing a great job supporting that. And just for your, lastly, for your information, for our insurance participation, we have 95 staff members who are in the PPO plan, 71 staff that are in the HMO plan, so that combines about 166 staff members that are in the medical plan. On the dental plan, we have about 170. We do have some staff that just would like to take the dental, where they may have the medical response, but they, so they're not still all, it's not all in either one or the other, both. I would say the majority are. So, again, they'll go into effect with new rates on July 1st. And that's the update on our.
We're going to move on now to Board of Finance, including IASB delegate, Len.
Just real quickly, last meeting on Friday, you know, we had a budget as well as
at 9:30 or at the staging area in Wooddale.